sir. Can you hear me now? Is it okay? Yeah? Okay, then we'll try it like this. So, I'm Tessa. I'm a social scientist and I work as an insight strategist at Transactive. Transactive is a trends interpretation agency. And Transactive started because the founders had noticed that when talking about trends, organizations always ask, great trend, but now what? So we use trends to answer business questions, and if you were an app, you would look something like this. What does trend X mean for my Y? And trend X can be sustainability or women or young people, and Y can be anything from marketing to strategy to design. So we use trends to answer different business questions for different organizations. We've worked with the real estate agency around the corner, but also with national and international organizations. And they're also in really different branches, such as banking and science and retail. So how do we do that? A, we study the behavior of people, and B, we interpret this research for organizations. So I will elaborate on this a bit further. First of all, we do research, and we don't do qualitative or quantitative research, so we don't go out on the street and interview people, but all the information you need is already available, so we do desk research and just gather all the information. We're talking about trends today, and when you're talking about trends, you often hear that trends are bullshit or fads, and we believe that's often rightly so, because there are two main problems when it comes to trends. The first problem is that the trend categorization is really unclear. If you're reading about trends, you don't know if they're long-term trends or short-term trends, and it's also really unclear if they're based upon research or maybe based upon someone's gut feeling. And the second problem with trends are the trend watchers themselves. Because trend watchers love to give the idea that trends are changing really fast, that's really hard to keep up, and they also give trends these unclear names that make it that much harder to see the big picture. And if you've ever tried Googling trends, then you might have noticed that there are a lot of different terms, and you might get stuck in this trend jungle of difficult trend names. We believe that trends should be made more simple instead of more complicated. So what we do is we create order in the trend chaos. Bless you. Well, when you're talking about trends, people often think of subjects as product trends, like Facebook or the iPad. And those are short-term trends that change pretty fast. And we believe that, well, they're also interesting to study, of course, but we study sociocultural trends. And these trends are the drivers behind the product trends. So for instance, if you look at Facebook, then you should ask yourself, why is Facebook such a success? And if you start answering that question, then you start noticing the mechanisms that lie behind the trend. And then you can identify the mindset of people that makes Facebook such a success, for example. So we study sociocultural trends, and we divide them in three different categories. So we have gender trends, and gender trends are the characteristics of men and women. Also generation trends, so those are the different age groups, for example, the baby boomers or the millennials. And third, we have mentality trends. And mentality trends don't specifically apply to men or women, and also not specifically to a certain age group, but they describe the mindset of a specific group in society. So you can think of a trend like sustainability, but also a trend like uncertain times that describes how people are reacting and acting in the uncertain times. The first lesson of today is that if you want to work with trends, you should always ask yourself the why question. So why is this trend, for instance, why is Facebook so popular, why is it such a success? And if you do that, you start noticing the long-term trends in society, because the interesting thing of these sociocultural trends is that they are long-term trends. They remain relevant for a long time. They change really slowly. And that means that you can really use them for business solutions. So that's the A part, the trend research. Now the B part, because if you stop here, organizations will still ask, great trend, but now what? So we also interpret trends for organizations. And we do this in various ways. These are a few examples of what we have done. And as you can see, we've used trends for sneakers, but also for apps and for marketing communication concepts and for packaging and products. So it's a really diverse way of using trends. And I'm talking about A and B, and there's one important side note, because we're doing both trend research and trend interpretation. And if you're going to interpret trends, then you need to get creative. And that basically means that you need different people than the scientists doing the research, because people can be generally differentiated into two groups. So you're either a left brainer or a right brainer. And the left brainers are the logical thinkers. They're the scientists and they know how to describe what is happening, but they find it difficult to tell you what you should do with it. And the creatives are the right brain people, the emotional thinkers, and the problem with creative people is that they usually don't really know the science. So we believe that the power lies in combining both left and right brainers. Most companies have only left or only right brainers. At Transactive, we work with both left and right brainers, and we believe that's really the only way of doing trend interpretation. Within the trend interpretation process, it's a pretty complex process, but I've simplified it a bit, and there are three basic phases that we go through. So I'll just elaborate a bit more on this. First, we have the insights phase, and during the first insights phase, we define the business question, and we also look at the insights that are already available, because a lot of companies do research themselves as well, so they have a lot of research reports, so we read them as well and then get to know the brand. Then we go to the second phase, the interpretation phase, and during this phase we select the relevant sociocultural trends from our database, and based upon, is it okay? Yeah. Based upon what we know of the insight from the brand itself and also our trends, we develop a creative framework. I hear myself. Is it okay? Yeah? Okay. And then the third phase is the implementation phase. And during this phase, we develop concepts and sometimes also implement these concepts. So I can imagine it's still a bit unclear how it exactly works. So what I'm going to do now is give a short trend presentation and then show you how we have used this trend for different business questions. I'm going to see if I can get to my water. Yes. So the trend I'm going to talk about is part of the generation trend millennials. The millennials are people between roughly 21 and 36. I'm guessing it's most people here as well. Yeah. The millennials have different characteristics that define them. It's a compliment. We have different characteristics that define the millennials. For example, it's a really smart generation, a generation that loves to be informed and search information. It's also a conscious generation. They're really conscious and positive, but realistic in their expectations. A third characteristic of this generation is that it's a pretty spoiled generation. They've been spoiled by their parents and by schools and everyone around them. So this is also a really me-centric group of people. And a fourth characteristic is visual culture, and that's the characteristic I will talk about today. So I'll give a short trend presentation of visual culture. So the world around us is becoming more and more visual. And that's not something new. It already happened in the 70s. But the last 10 years, you see a big acceleration of visual culture. And there are a few reasons for that. For one reason is the abundance of marketing that you see. And marketing communicates visually. But you also see that there are a lot of screens around us. And this generation is even called screenagers because they use so many screens. There are screens in your car, on your phone, he's looking at it right now, on your camera, but also screens in your public transport. If you're in the train or on the bus, you're looking at screens. And if you're visiting stores, there's also a lot of screens. But this generation not only passively consumes all those visuals, they also produce visuals. They love to play around with visuals and produce them themselves. And because they play around with visuals that much, they also love visual symbolism. This generation, for instance, is really attracted to visuals from their own youth, so when they were growing up. And if you're using them, for instance, in your communication, that really attracts the millennials. Of course, the visualization of culture is not something that's only happening to just the millennial generation. But the difference is that generations cope with it in a different way. So the older generations are a bit overwhelmed by the abundance of visuals, and the younger generation really knows how to filter out all the relevant parts for them. And one example of this generation difference is if you look at the mobile phone interface of apps, younger generations will just look at the apps at the symbol and choose the right app, while older generations will still read the tiny text below. Since everything around us is becoming more visual, that also impacts has an impact on our behavior. So a recent study has shown that for teenagers, not Google is the most important search engine, but YouTube. So teenagers are YouTubing their information. And you can make even the most boring data interesting by making it visually attractive to these millennials. So the use of infographics, it's almost a trend within a trend, because the use of infographics is growing rapidly, and they attract millennials. So I've said it in the beginning, this generation is really attracted to visual symbolism. They also give more meaning to visuals and, for instance, logos. Nike has a really strong visual identity. If you know, you show the Nike swoosh, then everybody will know they're watching a Nike ad. You don't need to see the Nike name anymore. But the difference between generations is that if you ask, for instance, someone who's 50 and you show them the Nike swoosh, and you ask them, well, what do you think? What do you see? Then they'll say, yeah, it's a Nike swoosh, it's a sports brand. But if you ask the same question to a millennial, the millennial will probably say, well, of course they will recognize it's a sports brand, but they also will see more like the mentality part of Nike. So they also recognize the just do it. The same way that Apple not only stands for computers, but also for design. So this generation is really visually oriented. One way of consuming all those visuals is by tattooing them. In the UK, 1 in 3 people have a tattoo nowadays. And they're not just tattooing butterflies. They're also tattooing brands and brand logos because they're so attracted to them. And as I've said in the beginning, they're not just passive consumers of these visuals. So they're not just copy-pasting brand logos onto their skin, but they're also playing around with it. As you can see on the right, there are a few skateboards that are turned into look like batteries. And some brands even have a really strong visual identity that it doesn't even matter what you put on it, you still know what it is. So for instance, this candy bar, even if you read Snickers, then you still know it's a Mars, because their visual identity is so strong. So I have one last example of visual culture. I was wondering if anyone here recognizes this brand. It's fun. People usually say Google or Lego, also Microsoft. It is PlayStation. And I will show you again. PlayStation used the geometric forms of their controller and turned them into a playground. Just a fun way of playing with visuals and visual culture. Okay, so this is really short, the trend presentation of visual culture. If you have looked at a trend, then always do a basic interpretation. And before doing an interpretation specifically to answer a business question, always do a basic one first, because then you get a more holistic view of the trend, and you can also use it as a checklist for different concepts that you've made. So first, ask yourself if you can change your text into visuals. Whether you're a bank or a grocery store, just look at the possibility of making your communication more visual. And also use the symbols and visual language of the millennials. So use the stuff that they grew up with just to attract the millennials. And be playful and intelligent when doing so. And always remember that this generation is not just a passive consumer of visuals, so always think of the possibility of customization and co-creation for your customers. Okay, so back to the app. What does visual culture mean for my why? I will give three different examples of how we've used visual culture to answer different business questions. So the first one, what does visual culture mean for my identity? And often if you think of identity, you think of a brand logo, such as Nike. And marketeers often say, oh, don't touch our logo, because it's like, don't touch it. And millennials, if they know a logo really well, then they love playing around with the logos. So why not, if you want to reach millennials, play around with your logo. So one example is the Dutch TV station, Netherlands 3, they have a really recognizable logo that's always at the top of the screen with a tree, but they also program a lot of music. So why not, if you're programming music, just alter your logo a little bit, also show a tree, but do it in a rock symbol way. Another example is Asics, the sports brand. Asics is not, it's already in the name. You can make it really visual. It's A and 6. So why not play around with it a little bit and just attract millennials by doing so? Okay, so second example, what does visual culture mean for my packaging? And we've already seen that this generation loves to be smart and also loves to be informed by infographics. They're really attracted to these infographics. So, well, milk is a rather boring commodity product. Milk is just milk. Why not make the package more interesting by turning it into an infographic? And you can also use the symbols of their youth on the packaging to attract millennials. So pixel-like 8-bit images, or even give them the chance to produce packages themselves. So one last example. What does visual culture mean for my marketing? This is a concept we made for Belgacom. They're a Belgian telecom company. And they asked us to come up with new ideas for products, for communication, for positioning. And one of the concepts was a marketing concept. The main competition in Belgium consists of BASE, Telenet, and Mobistar. And these three other players in Belgium are not from Belgium. Well, they're based in Belgium, but their owners are from other countries. So why not play with the logos of the competition and just playfully show that you're really the only real Belgian telecom company? Okay, so last but not least, 6 tips if you want to start working with trend interpretation and trends. First of all, prepare. As we've seen in the beginning, left-brainers and right-brainers should work together when you're doing trends interpretation. And also, define a clear business question. Try to summarize the business question into what does X mean for Y? And third, always ask the why question. Make sure that you understand the drivers behind the trend that you're using. As I've said, always make a basic interpretation before starting to interpret specifically, because then you get a more holistic view of how you can use a trend. And always visualize your concept. And this is really important, because if I'm a left-brainer, I think textually I have problem if someone explains a concept to me, I can translate it visually in my head. All left-brainers have that problem. If you're a right-brainer, then you don't understand why they're not getting it, and I just don't understand what I should get. So if you visualize your concepts, then the left-brainers understand what you mean, and it's also easier to talk about it. And last, structure your evaluation. It's really easy if you have a concept to say, I don't like it, it's not good enough. But if you structure your evaluation, you force yourself to not only look at what's not good, but also what is good and what you can do to improve it. Okay, so this is really short how we do trend interpretation. I hope it may have inspired you for today and your work. So if you have any questions, I'm glad to answer them.